is the passion that cricket and cricketers evoke in Sri Lankans. This is the love that I strive every day of my career to be worthy of. Coming back to our cricket, the World Cup also brought less welcome changes with the start of detrimental cricket board politics and the transformation of our cricket administration from a volunteer-led organization run by well-meaning men of integrity into a multi-million dollar organization that has been in turmoil ever since. In Sri Lanka, cricket and politics have been synonymous. The efforts of the Honorable Gamini Dissanayake were instrumental in getting Sri Lanka test status. He was also instrumental in building Asgiriya, the international cricket stadium in Kandy. In the infancy of our cricket, it was impossible to sustain the game without state patronage and funding. When Australia and West Indies refused to come to our country for the World Cup, it was through government channels that the combined World Friendship 11 came and played in Colombo to show the world that it was safe to play cricket there. The importance of cricket to our society also meant that at all times it enjoys benevolent state patronage. For Sri Lanka to be able to select a national team, it must have membership of the sports ministry. No team can be fielded without the final approval of the sports minister. It is indeed a unique system where the board-appointed selectors at any time can be overruled and asked to reselect a side already chosen. The sports minister can also exercise his unique powers to dissolve the cricket board if investigations reveal corruption or financial irregularity. With the victory in 1996 came power and money to the board and players. Players from within the team itself became involved in power games. Officials elected to power in this way in turn manipulated player loyalty to achieve their own ends. At times, board politics would spill over into the team, causing rift, ill feeling, and distrust. The only shining example to the contrary I can remember was the interim committee headed by Mr. Vijay Mallasekara, who's sitting here today in the audience. Accountability and transparency in administration and credibility of conduct were lost in a mad power struggle that would leave Sri Lankan cricket with no consistent and clear administration. Presidents and elected executive committees would come and go. Government-picked interim committees would be appointed and dissolved. After 1996, the cricket board has been controlled and administered by a handful of well-meaning individuals, either personally or by proxy, rotated in and out depending on appointment or election. Unfortunately, to consolidate and perpetuate their powers, they opened the door of the administration to partisan cronies that would lead to corruption and wanton waste of cricket board finances and resources. It was and still is confusing. Accusations of vote buying and rigging, player interference due to lobbying from each side, and even violence at the AGMs, including the brandishing of weapons and ugly fistfights, have characterized cricket board elections for as long as I can remember. The team lost the buffer between itself and the cricket administration. Players had become used to approaching members in power, directly trading favors for mutual benefits. And by 1999, all these changes in administration and player attitudes had transformed what was a close-knit unit in 1996 into a collection of individuals with no shared vision or sense of team. The World Cup that followed in England was a debacle, a first-round exit. Fortunately, though, this proved to be the catalyst for further change within the dynamics of the Sri Lankan team. A new mix of players, a nice blend of youth and experience, provided the context in which the old hierarchical systems and structures within the team were dismantled. And in the decade that followed, under the more consensual leadership of Sanath, Marvin and Mahela, the team, continued to grow. In the new team culture forged since 1999, individuals are accepted. The only thing that matters is commitment and discipline to the team. Individuality and internal debate are welcome. Respect is not demanded but earned. There was a new commitment towards keeping the team safe from board turmoil. It has been difficult to fully exclude it from our team because there are constant efforts to drag us back in, and in times of weakness and doubt, players have crossed the line. Still, we have managed to protect and motivate our collective efforts towards one goal, winning on the field. We have to aspire to better administration. The administrators need to adopt the same values enshrined by the team over the years: integrity, transparency, commitment, and discipline. Unless the administration is capable of becoming more professional, forward-thinking, and transparent, then we risk alienating the common man. Indeed, this is already happening. Loyal fans are becoming increasingly disillusioned. This is a very dangerous thing, because it is not the administrators or players that sustain the game. It is the cricket-loving public. It is their passion that powers cricket. And if they turn their backs on cricket, then the whole system will come crashing down. The solution to this may be the ICC taking a stand to suspend member boards with any direct detrimental political interference and allegations of corruption and mismanagement. This will negate the ability of those boards to field representative teams or receive funding and other accompanying benefits from the ICC. But as a Sri Lankan, I hope we have the strength to find the answers ourselves. While the team structure and culture itself was slowly evolving, our on-field success was primarily driven by the sheer talent and spirit of uniquely talented players unearthed in recent times, players like Murali, Sanath, Aravinda, Mahela, and Lasit Malinga. Although our school cricket structure is extremely strong, our club structure remains archaic. With players diluted among 20 clubs, it does not enable the national coaching staff to easily identify and funnel talented players through for further development. The lack of competitiveness of the club tournament does not lend itself to producing hardened first-class professionals. Various attempts to change this structure, to condense and improve, have been resisted by the administration and the clubs concerned. The main reason for this being that any elected cricket board that offended these clubs runs the risk of losing their votes come election time. At the same time, the instability of our administration is a huge stumbling block to the rapid phase change that we need. Indeed, it is amazing that despite this system, we are able to produce so many world-class cricketers. Nevertheless, despite abundant natural talent, we need to change our cricketing structure. We need to be more Sri Lankan rather than selfish. We need to condense our cricketing structure to ensure that the best players are playing against each other at all times. We need to do this with an open mind, allowing both innovative thinking and free expression. In some respects, we are doing that already, especially our coaching department, which is actively searching for unorthodox talent. We have recognized and learned that our cricket is stronger when it is free-spirited, and we therefore encourage players to express themselves and be open to innovation. If we are able to seize the moment, then the future of Sri Lanka's cricket remains very bright. I pray we do, because cricket has such an important role to play in our island's future. Cricket played a crucial role during the dark days of Sri Lanka's civil war, a period of enormous suffering for all communities. But the conduct and performance of the team will have even greater importance as we enter a crucial period of reconciliation and recovery. An exciting period where all Sri Lankans aspire to peace and unity. It is also an exciting period for cricket, where the reintegration of isolated communities in the north and the east open up new talent pools. The spirit of cricket can and should remain the guiding force for good within our society, providing entertainment and fun, but also a shining example to all of how we should approach our lives. The war is now over. Sri Lanka looks towards a new future of peace and prosperity. I am eternally grateful for this. It means that my children will grow up without war and violence being a daily part of their lives. They will learn of its horrors, not firsthand, but perhaps in history class or through conversation, for it is important that they understand and appreciate the great and terrible price our country and our people paid for the freedom and security they now enjoy. In our cricket, we display a unique spirit, a spirit enriched by lessons learned from a history spanning over 2.5 millennia. In our cricket, you see the character of our people, our history, culture, tradition, our laughter, our joy, our tears, our regrets, and our hopes. It is rich in emotion and talent. My responsibility as a Sri Lankan cricketer is to further enrich this beautiful sport, to add to it and enhance it and leave it a richer legacy for the cricketers to follow. I will do that keeping paramount in my mind my Sri Lankan identity. Play the game hard and fair and be a voice with which Sri Lanka can speak proudly to the world. My loyalty will be to the ordinary Sri Lankan fan, the 20 million hearts beating collectively as one to our island rhythm, filled with an undying and ever loyal love for this, our game. Fans of different races, castes, ethnicities, and religions who together celebrate their diversity by uniting for cricket, our common national cause. Those fans are my foundation. They are my family. I will play my cricket for them. Their spirit is the true spirit of cricket. With me are all my people. I am Tamil, I am Sinhalese, I am Muslim and Burger. I am a Buddhist, I am a Hindu, a follower of Islam and Christianity. But above all, today and always, I will be proudly Sri Lankan. Thank you.